Okay, showtime. All right, would you put your phones away for me, por favor? Silence and conceal, that'd be great. Good to see you. Good to have you. I'm going to pray. Two announcements. And then a really good speaker. All right, let's pray. Father, thank you for the nice weather outside. Thank you for the chance to be here. Quiet our hearts, quiet our minds for what you have in store for us. And ultimately, Lord, that we would leave here wiser, closer to you. I'm thankful for what we've learned. In your name, amen. All right, in the announcement category. My favorite's coming up. All right. The girls are still going, girls hoopsters. So tomorrow night at the Bellevue College at 6 p.m., they will play Kings for the right to go to Glory Land, which is also Yakima. So I don't know how much it costs, but bring your ASB because I think you get a discount on that. So good job, girls, making it that far. And what? Oh, there's a blue out. So I'm sensing you wear blue to the blue out. Is that? Do I gather that correctly? All right, it's good. Now, can it be navy or royal? What about, how do we feel about aquamarine? All right, so wear blue to, what's that? School colors. All right, that helps. Viking blue. All right, now something else.
When I try to recruit in the classroom, usually I go in and I just say, hey, we have a blood drive coming up and we need you to donate blood because 20% of the blood donations that we get in Western Washington come from high school donors just like yourself. Once every 2 minutes in Western Washington, somebody needs blood.
I swung out over the creek bed and something must have happened because I fell about 25 feet. I had a lot of internal bleeding, enough that I wasn't gonna make it if I didn't get some blood transfusions. Receiving blood meant saving my life.
I get blood once a month because my blood, red blood cells are abnormal. Before I have my transfusion, I feel weak and tiresome. And after I have it, I feel energized. I feel very active, like Energizer Bunny. I'd like to say thanks for donating blood, because without blood, I wouldn't live.
I was diagnosed with sickle cell anemia when I was 3 years old, and I have been getting blood transfusions ever since. Last week, I had a surgery, and I got 5 different people's blood. And while I was laying in the bed, I was like, oh my gosh, you know, like, I wonder what the people, you know, I wonder who gave me this blood, if it was a boy or a girl, or like, what are they doing right now? And I wish they could know that right now they're saving my life and giving me a blood transfusion.
Well, a lot of times when I'm talking to kids, they'll kind of come up to me and be a little bit scared about it, and they'll be a little bit fidgety, and they'll be like, well, I'm a little bit afraid of this, like, I'm afraid of needles, or I've never given blood before, or can I play sports after I give blood? A lot of kids don't realize that it only takes a short amount of time to donate, and one donation can save up to 3 lives.
I'm doing it for kind of selfish reasons. I've always been terrified of having blood drawn, and so I wanted to prove to myself that I could do it without freaking out. And it's going well.
you know, if you donate blood one time, it helps, I think, three people. And so it feels good to know you're helping out.
Well, my first time donating blood, and I was kind of nervous because, you know, needles sticking into your skin and all that. Really, I thought the worst part was getting your finger pricked to, you know, see if you have enough iron in your blood. It didn't hurt once they put the needle in. It was just, I just sat there and I was fine.
It feels really good knowing that I've helped people out, and I think it's a good cause. I think more people should do it too. I think too many people are scared and that they find excuses not to take it.
It's kind of a cool thing how you can spend a little much of your time and then you can save a life. Yeah, that just makes you feel good inside.
I heard 1.3 lives. Yeah. That's amazing.
It feels good after you get blood, and like people say, oh no, I'm not gonna get blood because there's gonna be a poke and oh, I'm scared. But if people were like that, you know, so many people would die because they don't have blood. Like so many people.
It's not such a little thing to have to go through to be able to give so much.
Being a blood drive coordinator has meant a lot to me and has actually inspired me to give for the rest of my life.
And have you opened your door? Give something more, a whole new light, the gift of life, and are you looking to help? Give more of yourself, consider yourself, consider yourself. Consider yourself, consider yourself as.
Please welcome Kenny Song and Jordan Akers to the big show here for more information on giving blood.
I hope you guys enjoyed that video. Just to add on some facts, do you guys know that like 1 pint of blood can save 3 lives? I had no idea.
And 16% of the blood supply comes from high school drives.
And it said in the video, but like about 18%, 20% of high schools in Western Washington are the people that give blood.
High school students give over 21,000 units of blood each year.
And it's been, ever since 2003, we haven't had a blood drive at Bellevue Christian. And so this year, we're bringing it back.
So it's Monday, March 21st, 7:30 to 1:30.
It's in the LRC. The LRC is gonna be closed all day, so I'm sorry gamers that go on the computers all the time. But yeah, it's in the LRC all day.
Students 16 years old and older can donate. If you're 16 or 17, you need a parent permission slip. BCS has over 200 students who can donate, like are over 16. So, and our goal is only 25 to 40, so I feel like that can be easily reached. Teachers and parents will also be allowed to donate.
So there are going to be sign-up sheets, probably on a table around school. And the times are from 7:30 a.m. to 1:30 p.m. on that day, March 21st. And so if you can sign up, if you're 16, 17, 18, then feel free to sign up. If you're 16 or 17, you got to bring a permission slip. If you're 18, you're your own guardian, so you're okay. Be sure to bring your photo ID. That's always important. And speaking from personal experience, remember to drink fluids and eat really well. I didn't do that once, and the nurse pricked me like 15 times to find a vein. It was not fun. So you gotta drink really well, and you gotta eat well. It takes less than an hour to start to finish, so it really doesn't take that much of your time. Once you sign up, you're just gonna go to the LRC, give blood. And actually, the fact is that the actual donation only takes about 10 minutes. So someone at school has given a lot of blood, Dr. Rivera. He got his, I think, 6-gallon, was it 6-gallon pin? Like, no, not at the same time. Yeah, and you know, I think that's a... If he can give 6 gallons over the period of his life, I'm sure that we can give 6 gallons as well, all together. So let's do this.
Speaking of Dr. Rivera, he has an update for you, kind of a proud BCS moment, actually. So would you welcome the good doctor, Mr. Rivera.
That it wasn't 6 gallons in one donation. Hey, I wanted to give you an update on the fundraiser for the Perkins Family Book Fund. I was so blown away. We counted the money yesterday, and you guys gave $530 toward the books that were burned in the fire. So thank you for your generosity, and I'm sure that we'll get a message from the Perkins family. And so be as generous when it comes to the blood drive. Thank you.
Thanks, sir. All right. Our guest today comes all the way from, I believe it's Kirkland now. Did we get annexed into as a church? Brandon Schumann is the worship pastor at North Shore Community Church, and he's here today. I'll let him kind of introduce himself as he goes along, but would you please welcome Mr. Brandon Schumann to the big stage.
Thanks, man. Hi. That was weak. Hi. No. Hi. Cool. So here's the deal. Like, you guys go to a Christian school, right? Raise your hand if you go to a Christian school. I'm joking. So you go to a Christian school. You've heard a bunch of speakers before in your life, right? Yes. Yes. So, like, I'm a worship pastor, so I don't talk a lot. Like, I talk in, like, 20-second increments. Like, I memorize the music, right? And then I'm like, okay, I have 20 seconds to, like, say something profound. Because if I talk too long, then you're like, why are you talking? You're supposed to be singing. And then I keep singing. So I'm not, all that to say, I'm not here to, like, impress you guys or wow you guys. Like, I'm just going to tell you my story. Cool? I'm just going to share my testimony with you guys, okay? So my name's Brandon. I am the worship pastor at North Shore Community Church. I've been on staff there for 7 years. I've been a worship pastor for 10 years. And yeah, I'm just going to tell you my story, tell you how God got a hold of my life, and then I'm going to sing a song for you guys at the end because I'm a worship pastor. So why would I not sing a song? That'd be weird, right? Yeah. Yes. You guys are really responsive. Thank you. All right. First picture. This is kind of blurry and a little bit scary, but there you go. That's me. Hold on. Before you laugh at me, you're a bad person. Before you laugh at me, I was 3 months premature when I was born, so I was 2 pounds, 2 ounces, which is crazy, right? And after I was born, I dropped to like 115, which is not a lot, and so I had to be in the hospital for like 3 months to be a little incubator, and I was born in the 80s, so like not a lot of technology for really premature babies, but enough to keep me alive. So my parents are super thankful that I'm alive, because I could have had a bunch of health complications, but I did not. And I'm super glad that God kept me around. So anyway, I grew up in a really musical family. Here's another picture of me. Totally not wearing any clothes there. Don't worry about it. I'm like 2 years old, and I'm playing xylophone with a spoon, because that's what I did when I was a little kid. My grandpa was a 60s rock star, like literally, and you guys don't know the band that he was in, so I'm not even going to tell you because it doesn't matter. But he has been a musician my whole life, and my uncle is a musician, and I have a bunch of musicians in my family. But one thing I didn't have in my family is there's no Christians, like none. I have zero Christian heritage in my family. I think I have like some great uncle twice removed that may have been a Christian. I don't even know. So I grew up in a pretty healthy family, but I didn't grow up in a Christian family at all. And one thing that my family struggled with was marriage. So, like, everybody got divorced in my family and remarried and then divorced again and remarried. And so there's a lot of like marital issues in my family. My parents got divorced when I was 4, and I was obviously really sad about it. I was confused because I was a little kid, and my mom remarried right away, but I lived with her and her husband for a while, but like my mom had divorced again and remarried again. My dad eventually remarried, and so my home life, though it was a pretty healthy family, all things considered, like everything was always changing. Like, raise your hand if you're an only child in the room, okay? So you kind of get the only child vibe. There's like 4 of you. That's cool. Hey, be proud of that. Just right up. Raise your hand if you're like an oldest, okay? Yeah, nice. Raise your hand if you're the youngest. Yeah, right. Woo, perfect. Okay, so check this out. No joke. From when I was like 4 years old, you guys, that guy stood out to you? 4 years old to like 16, I was an only child and an oldest and a second oldest at different parts of my life because my sibling groups were always changing. So that was rough for me. I was moving around a lot, and I was like, as you can probably tell, like I'm like 5'6". Will you stand up for a second? You're so tall. I love how tall you are. I am not tall, friends, okay? I am 5'6". Raise your hand if you're taller than me, okay? I'm proud of you. Okay, put your hands down. So I am shrinking, by the way. I don't believe that you're shrinking at all. Okay, so I was like, all throughout school, because my home life had some turmoil in it, I was like the short, chubby kid who kind of played music, but it wasn't like a cool thing. Like I play piano, I sing, I play the drums, I play guitar, I've been in a bunch of bands, I'll tell you about that later. But when I was a kid, like I started singing and playing piano when I was 4. And I've been pursuing it seriously since I was 4 as a professional musician. So, but that wasn't like a cool thing in my school. Do you guys know what I mean? Like some schools, it's kind of cool to be a musician. Other schools, like, no, you're not cool. So I wasn't cool. I was teased a lot because I really didn't have any sense of identity as a kid. Like I just knew that home life was rough and people weren't nice to me at school. So that was kind of my entire school life. I was never in a school more than 2 years because I was moving around a bunch with divorce and remarriage. So fast forward a little bit. I got invited to a youth group when I was 14. So freshman year of high school. I didn't even know what youth group was. I was like, is that Boy Scouts? Seriously, that was my question. Like, what's youth group? I've been to a church maybe like twice in my life before then. And both were like super awkward for me. And it was like this tight-knit group of people, and they didn't really welcome me in. And I was like, okay, this is weird. What's this? And I felt really judged. That was like my only church experience up until that point. So I go to this youth group, and all of a sudden I'm like, wow, there's something different about these students. I have no idea what it is, but there's something different. And I had no idea. Again, I was just kind of looking around going, okay, they're not clicky. Like, they're nice to each other. They're nice to me. This is crazy. Like, whatever these students have, I want it. That was actually my thought at the time. So pause just for a second in my story. I want to read a verse for you guys. So, and this is huge. This is a really big deal to me. This verse is out of John 13, verse 35. It says, by this all people will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another. Like, guys, you need to understand something. And I'm not just trying to be dramatic by this. I was having suicidal thoughts when I was 11. Okay? I was teased hard. I sat on the wall at recess and like watched people play. And my dad's new wife was not nice to me. Her kids weren't nice to me. I had all sorts of stuff going on. So for me to go to this youth group, this broken little dude, and be accepted was really a new concept for me. So if you guys are wondering like what your job is as Christians, like it's pretty much start with treating people well. Like that's powerful. That's really powerful to just kind of set aside social stuff, religious stuff, political stuff, set it aside for a second and love the person as a human, as a person who's created by God. Just start there, and amazing things happen when you treat people well. And amazingly damaging things happen when you don't treat people well. I know we've been told this since we were in kindergarten, so it feels really, duh, I'm supposed to be nice to people, but it's true. And that is a huge, that there introduced me to Jesus. That starting point is why I'm the husband I am today, and the father I am today, and the pastor I am today, because some Christian kids were nice to me, okay? That's huge. So, moving on. So, check this out. This is crazy. So, I'm at this youth group, right? And I give my life to Jesus. And for me, it's just like, it's all about Jesus. My family, again, healthy family, love them to pieces. Like, my whole family is what you would call Unitarian Universalist. That's a fancy word. Raise your hand if you know what that means. Great. Okay. So, what that means is you take whatever you want from any religion, and you just kind of mix it together, and that's your religion. So it's a worldview that kind of allows you to explore different religions and then just take what you like and not take what you don't like. So as you can probably gather, there's not a lot of accountability in that way of thinking because it's kind of all about whatever you think is true. So when I told my family that I was a Christian, they were like, what? So what they thought that meant was that I was like part of like Westboro Baptist Church. Raise your hand if you know what that is. Have you guys heard of that? So that's that crazy group of people who say horrible things and probably aren't Christians. I would put money on that. And I don't have a lot of money. So that, like, when I say that, I mean that. They're probably not Christians. In fact, I would say they aren't because of the hateful things that they're saying. But that's kind of what my family thought, because you look in the media and often Christians are portrayed that way. And I'm like, no, I don't. I'm 14. I didn't know about politics. I didn't know about other religions, really. I just knew that I just met Jesus, and that was a very powerful experience for me. So 3 weeks later, okay, you with me? 3 weeks later, I'm like praying and reading the Bible, and I've been doing those things for 3 weeks, mind you, and I feel like God says three things to me. He says, you're mine now. I'm the one who defines you. I'm the one who gives you your identity. Not these other kids, not your family. And the second thing was, stop dating. I'm like, oh, that sucks. But he said, stop, like, don't have a girlfriend right now, basically, until I tell you otherwise. And I'm in high school, so I'm like, oh, okay, that's a big one. And then the third thing he said is, you're going to be a pastor. So we're not going to waste any time. Let's go. So I'm 3 weeks in to this whole Jesus thing. So I go to my youth pastor, and I'm like, hey, am I crazy? Did I hear this right? And the youth pastor and the senior pastor and a couple of the elders are like, oh, you totally heard that right. That's from the Lord. So I just kind of went for it. Like, as soon as Jesus gave me identity, as soon as he gave me purpose, I just said, okay, let's go. Because I didn't know what my purpose was. I didn't know who I was, why I was here, why there was all this pain everywhere, why there was pain inside of me. I had none of that. In Christ, I got all of that. And so I just started growing in my faith. One verse that he used in my life really early on, it's a little bit longer one, so stick with me here, is Romans 8, 31 through 39. Get there here 1 second, guys. All right. Stick with me. It's kind of long. What then shall we say to these things? And they're talking about persecution in this context. If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for all of us, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died. More than that, he was raised. He was at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or danger, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels or rulers, nor things present or things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. So, to me, I wasn't raised in the church. I don't have, you know those like Bible songs that you learned when you were five that will just get in your head on Saturday morning and you hate them because they don't leave, but they're like a nice memory and they help you memorize scripture? I don't have any of that. As a church kid, because my wife is a church kid, how it's sometimes easy to confuse pursuing holiness and pursuing being like Christ with earning your salvation and following a list of rules. You know how those things can kind of blend together? Well, for me, because how I was raised, I just kind of went, well, of course I don't earn my salvation. Like, I don't feel this pressure to prove that I'm a Christian. I don't feel this pressure to have everything all together because this is all about Jesus, right? And so, but what I realized as I grew in my faith and as I got more Christian friends, because I didn't have any Christian friends before that, was I was like, this is kind of a Christian kid thing that you have to overcome. And not like people who aren't raised in the church and they come to Christ, there's like a certain amount of things you have to work through. But if you're raised in the church, like you have to work through just as much stuff, because you've probably heard this. I did not make this up, but you heard the whole like, God doesn't have grandkids. Have you guys heard that before? Like you have to actually be God's kid. You have to actually surrender to Jesus. Just because your parents know Jesus doesn't mean that you do. But that can like put a weird pressure on you, right? Where you're like, I think I'm a Christian, but my parents think I'm a Christian. I can be a Christian here, but then I can maybe party a little bit, and that's not a big deal. Like, this is real stuff that you guys have to think about, that I had to think about just from kind of the other side of it because I wasn't raised in the church. So what was cool about the youth group that I was in is it was like okay to talk about that kind of stuff. And I would just encourage you guys and your group of friends in your classes to actually be vulnerable, and because that's how you grow. Like, to sit there and try to pretend like you're believing something or acting a certain way based on the context that you're in. Oh, I'm at home, I'm gonna act, this is home version of me, or this is church version of me. Like, it's just a lot of work, and it's not really worth it. So that would be like the only thing I would preach at you today, is like, just be honest about where you're at with people that you trust, and allow the Holy Spirit through your relationships, through His Word, to bring you to truth, to help you deal with, whether it's a theological thing, whether it's a suffering thing, whatever. So that meant a lot to me to have a youth group that would do that. And I would encourage you guys with your non-Christian friends, they're not your project, they're not weird, they're not against you, like, and they're also not really asking you to solve their problems. They're looking at you and saying, I wonder what Jesus looks like. And if you can just kind of simplify that a little bit and live in such a way that is honoring to Jesus, so when you mess up, say, sorry, I messed up. Like, that speaks volumes to them. So I'm going to move on here. So did the whole high school thing. I led worship in junior high youth group. And then I went to Bible college right away. And I started leading worship there. I got my bachelor's in pastoral ministry with kind of a worship pastor emphasis. And I got to go on tour. I got to record a couple CDs. I got to play. I'm like older than you, so I'm going to name a few bands. You're going to be like, I don't know who those bands are. You're dumb, and that's fine. But I got to be share a stage with Mute Math and Thousand Foot Crutch and who else? And there's a couple other ones that I just forgot. But that was super fun. I got to lead worship in like hundreds of different churches and go on tour. And that was a great experience for me because I got to lead worship in small churches who have like never had drum sets before. And the older ladies were really nice, but really didn't like the kind of music that we did. But they were really nice, and they fed us really good food, and it worked out. All the way to like 3,000-person youth events with like pyrotechnics and lights and lasers and smoke. And so it was really, really a cool time. And then I became a worship pastor. After that, I graduated college in 2009, so I'm 31 right now. Met and married my wife. Here's my wife. She's gorgeous. Little side note, like, you really want to let God be Lord of your dating relationships, because then this happens, okay? I'm a goober, right? She's gorgeous. It worked out for me. So when Jesus tells you to do something, especially if it's hard, like, hey, don't pursue a dating relationship right now until I give you peace to pursue somebody, you really want to listen to Him, because He wants to hook you up with an awesome spouse. That's actually how Jesus feels about you. He loves you. He wants you to have a healthy marriage. One thing that my wife and I are very passionate about is not only pursuing healthy marriage, but also premarital counseling. Like, her and my background, we don't have any healthy marriages, like, anywhere in our family, anywhere. So we knew going into marriage that we have to keep our eye on Jesus and let Him and let other strong couples who know Him mentor us. And so we've been married for 9 years now. We have two kids. Here are my two kids. Say, aw. That was really bad. That's fine. I need more affirmation from you than this. Wow, thanks. That was a lot of effort for you, I'm sure. Okay, so That's my daughter, Eileen. She's 4 and a half. She starts kindergarten this fall, and she's super excited. And that's my son, Ezekiel. We call him Baby Zeke. He's 9 months old, and he's awesome. I love being a dad a lot, like a lot. I love you guys. I'm glad I'm here. Pretty much rather be at home, like all the time, no matter what I'm doing. Leading worship at North Shore for thousands of people. Yeah, I'd rather be home. My family's awesome. I love being a dad. I love being a husband. And so, yeah, that's my story. And you know what? If that was boring to you and you didn't get anything out of it, that's totally fine, because God uses all sorts of things to reach out to us. But if you can resonate with any of that, if you can relate with some of that, I'd love to chat with you after, because, you know, it's so easy for us to add stuff to the gospel. It's like, I'm a pastor. I'm an ordained minister. Like, I'm like, whatever. It's easy for me. It's easy for you to say, oh, well, the gospel, like Jesus loves us, wants us to be with us, died on the cross. We've heard this a million times. I'm not even going to finish, because you can finish it for me. It's so easy for us to say, oh, no, that's too simple. Like, I need to add stuff to that. But you really can't, because then it becomes something else. I'm passionate about the gospel. I am passionate that Jesus is actually real, that Jesus actually changes lives, and that he's called us as his people to live out the gospel, but out of this sense of identity. Not like, oh, there's pressure on you, just go be perfect. No, you hear your identity from God, and then you live that out. And so that's how I'm trying to live my life. It's like an everyday thing. You guys know that. So yeah, that's it. That's my story up to this part. I would love to sing a song for you guys. And if you know it, you can sing with me. If not, that's totally cool. But I found this song a couple years ago. It's called Good, Good Father. And it talks about how we're loved, that he's good, and we're loved. And it's a simple song, but it's one that I want to share with you guys. So if you let me, I'm just going to sing it. Sure, that slide works. And as I do, guys, you've heard a bunch of worship songs before, but I want to encourage you, if this song is for you, if you need to hear these words right now, don't let the fact that you're in school prevent you from connecting spiritually right now. You don't have to compartmentalize yourself. You don't have to feel embarrassed to even worship now if you need to, but I'm just going to sing this for us here.
Well, I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Well, I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers only you provide, because you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all. You are perfect in all of peace so unexplainable, I can hardly think as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still in the love, love. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
I'd love to just pray for you guys really quick, if I could. You pray with me. God, we need that reminder. That's the foundation of our faith, is Christian.